Nobody wants to get united. Like, what we gotta do is meet everybody on 149th Street at the bench.
So, a couple of weeks ago, we went ahead and analyzed the work of Gesser. Somebody that you guys were excited to see me break down, and we had a lot to teach from his work. But in that video, a lot of you guys wanted to see me break down the work of his homie, Osteo. And at the time, I mean, I've never seen the guy's work, no disrespect to him, but I gotta be real with you, I'm really glad that you guys went ahead and made me go ahead and take a look at him. Because he's got some incredible stuff, and that is who we're gonna be breaking down in today's video. Now, check this piece out. This one right here is really dope, because he's doing something here that I find really interesting. It's not something that you really see in graffiti. You see, because a lot of graffiti artists, they love the bevel technique on their letters. For those of you guys who are unfamiliar, the bevel looks a little something like this. And what's happening here is you have this more triangular shape that's being created within the letter by having a highlight going down the center. And on one side you have, well, the highlight, and on the other side you have the shadow. And the further away from the center they get, the more they decrease in intensity. Now we can see this in Osteo's work right here on the S, and in various other areas as well, where he has the highlight on one side and the shadow on the other. The only issue is, he also uses this just to straight up highlight certain areas that aren't a bevel, like right here on the top of the S. So he's kind of bouncing between using it as a bevel and using it as just straight up a highlight and an interior detail. He does the same thing with the shadow as well, bouncing between doing more of an occlusion shadow, as we can see, between the T and the E right here, and the O and the S right here, and then just straight up using it to shade, as we can see here in this arrow, and right here on the bottom corner of the S, where it's not really an occlusion shadow there. And I think this was actually really necessary for the piece, because this gives him the versatility he needs in order to take this piece that otherwise wouldn't have contrasted very much and make it pop off the wall. I think that was a really smart decision on his point. Now with this right here, we get a good look at what uniformity can do for your piece. You see, while he may not have a ton in the way of line uniformity and similarity, he has a lot of letter uniformity and similarity, and a lot of details that occur just specifically to flow with other details. For example, if he puts one of these extensions on one side of the name, then he's got to do it somewhere else as well. You'll see that occur with the arrows as well, where he's got three arrows on the left, three arrows on the right. Now it doesn't always have to be this symmetrical, you can go ahead and mix it up a little bit, but this is how he chose to go ahead and do it. And this same principle of keeping things uniform and having things occur multiple times throughout your piece doesn't just take place with the big features like arrows and various extensions, they also take place with a little bit of chips that he does. As you'll see, the arrow here on the left hand side is actually made from chips. We can see the two of them right there. But then he decides to add another set of chips down here on the bottom, and back on the top, and back on the bottom again, and then once again on the right hand side. That's that uniformity I'm referring to, and this even occurs inside of the letters themselves with the interior details. You have these little square details here, with a little bit more in here, and a little bit more here on the right hand side. That's good awareness, and that's something that you should be doing in your pieces as well if you haven't already. It's a pretty simple thing to do, and more of you intermediate to advanced graffiti artists are probably long doing this by now. But for you newer graffiti artists, this is something that's gonna definitely help your work look a little bit more quality. This right here is how you go ahead and create dope work on a budget. Like, his half of his filling color is the background, and a lot of the work he's doing is more so done with the outlines themselves. If we look at the letters aren't really all that detailed, they're pretty simplified. Nothing super crazy, nothing super wild style. I think it's important to sometimes take a step back and appreciate these simple but really clean and nice pieces, because newer graffiti artists have a tendency to believe that everything needs to be super wild. I mean, if my Instagram DMs tell me anything, it's that most new graffiti artists do not keep it simple at all whatsoever. But look at the power of keeping it simple. Now granted, this is still much more stylized than what the average new graffiti artist is going to be capable of. But just look at the letters. This right here proves that you don't need to have crazy letters in order to have dope style. Because this piece is awesome. This is probably one of my favorite ones he's done. It's extremely creative, very well done, but the letters are still legible. The letters are still clean, they're crisp, and at the end of the day, that's what matters. As long as the letters are correct, then you're golden. And he did this to an expert level. But this piece right here, oh, yo, this is dope. That blue background contrasting with the beautiful warm color 3D and the deep, rich fill-in, gotta love it, man. This is real good stuff. Now notice, the actual background color is pretty light. Ignore the shine on the left-hand side here because, you know, the sunlight is beaming from over there, so it's influencing the color a lot. Let's focus more so on how the color looks in the center of the piece and to the right of that. We can see that the blue isn't all that dark. It's not super bright, but it's not all that dark either. And he introduces a 3D here, which gets extremely bright, but it does have some shading applied to it. And as a result, he's gonna need to contrast this from the actual background itself. He does this by applying a drop shadow. This helps the letters to pop off. If you really wanna get a good look at the contrast here, check out this bottom portion of the E, and then look at this extension right here. You'll notice that the bottom portion of the E pops out a lot more than this extension does over here. Keep in mind the lesson from earlier, he still is using a lot of letter uniformity, having details occur multiple times throughout the piece on various letters. This kind of acts as the glue for your letters. This is something that you need in order to go ahead and make the letters look like they're one part of a whole. Now, if you're observant, if you got a keen eye, you probably noticed a little detail that doesn't happen throughout the entire piece. And that's the star right here on the bottom left of the T. You'll notice it's the only place it happens, but because it's in the center of the piece, it helps to make that area the focal point. Not only that, it still has line uniformity and similarity. Having a detail occur only one time and putting it more towards the center of your piece, it kind of makes that detail more of a center point for the actual piece as a whole. And it doesn't necessarily mean it has to be the focal point either. This also has a big function to it as well, because it's filling in the negative space underneath the S. Now granted, there still is a good amount of negative space down here, and that's something that Osteo actually uses to his advantage. It's because of negative space that we actually get depth, and if you have 3D and you're trying to show depth, well then that 3D needs to have negative space. We can see that here in the O. The O is completely filled with positive space, and as a result, the center part of the O doesn't have a lot of depth, but this area of the E has more depth. Same thing for the T, and even this little space between the S and the T, even that has a little bit more depth. That's an example of how negative space can work to your benefit. So having this big area completely surrounded by 3D and drop shadow goes a great way to help his depth. Not to mention, this extension is beautifully done. This extension stops that negative space from becoming way too much, because it fills a good amount of it, with not only the fill-in of the letter itself, but also the 3D. But furthermore, this extension helps to hold the O upright, because the O is positioned a little bit higher than the later portion of the name, like the T and the E. This kind of helps in order to keep his descender line a little bit more uniform. And that's something that we can actually see in another piece right here. His T and his E tend to dip down low, as we're seeing right here in this piece. But then he throws an extension once again from the center of the S and drops it underneath the O in order to go ahead and hold it up. This extension with the T and the E once again helps to develop his descender line, because his baseline occurs more so around this area. So that is really solid stuff. Also, remember how in the first piece we talked about contrast and how his fill-in didn't really contrast the 3D? And as a result, he was kind of forced to shade his letters as well as his 3D in order to create that contrast? We're seeing the exact opposite happen in this piece right here. He doesn't really have any shading. Don't mistake in this fade from blue to dark red into light red shading. That's merely just a gradient of colors. But because the values of his fill-in never really get all that bright, he has a lot of contrast as it is. He doesn't need extra contrast from shading much of anything. I mean, it looks like he might have hit this with a light blue in order to shade the occlusion shadows of the 3D, but it's extremely hard to see to the point where it's not really gonna help as far as contrast with the letters is concerned. This guy's work is awesome, man. I really thank you guys for going ahead and recommending him to me. If you guys want me to check out somebody else's work, feel free to leave them in the comments down below. I'd love to go ahead and do a breakdown of some more awesome graffiti. But on that note, if you guys enjoyed today's video, remember to hit the like button. It helps out a bunch. And if you're new here, feel free to subscribe. Become part of the smartest graffiti community anywhere online. If you want some more graffiti content, we got the best how to do graffiti tutorials right up here on the top. And on the bottom, we got more graffiti content in general. But with all that said, guys, I want to thank you for watching. I'll catch you guys next week. But until then, peace.